form a quorum, and it's the appointed time to start. This is a meeting of the Bills Committee on Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions Amendment Bill 2015. This is the third meeting. Agenda item, matters arising. On the 30th of November 2015, we convened a meeting to listen to views from deputations and individual members of the public. And the administration will be providing a response in writing in due course. As for the response to matters raised by members at a meeting on the 30th of November and the 6th of November, the two papers have been issued to members on the 27th of November and the 11th of December, respectively, and the reference numbers are CB1204-1516-02 and CB1283-1516-02. Additionally, our legal advisor has also written to the administration in respect of certain legal and drafting matters in the bill on the 10th of December 2015. Is a paper CB1283-1516-03. A written response will be given by the administration in due course, and we'll be dealing with those issues when we proceed to cross-by-cross examination. May I now invite the administration to introduce CB1203-1516-02 and CB1283-1516-02. And then the floor will be open for members to raise questions. Deputy Secretary, thank you. I will introduce the first paper, and then Mr. Au would do the same for the second one. This paper was issued on the 27th of November 2015. It's a paper to respond to matters raised by members in respect of winding up of companies and also the operation of the relevant provisions in the winding up legislation. And what we want to say is that the protection of wages on the insolvency procedure is a different set of procedure vis-a-vis the insolvency legislation, and we have consulted the Labor Department and have received relevant information and data. On the question of the maximum amount of advancement in Clause 6. On winding up, the employees will not be affected, and that is the so-called 828 provision, because there will be the surrogacy right of the taken up by the protection of wages on insolvency fund. So that's why we don't think that there's a need to make the changes as suggested. And also for the preferential payment or the order of priority of payment for unsecured creditors. According to the law principle of pari passu, it's important, and that is the international norm. And all common law jurisdictions uphold the same principle. For special cases, we have been dealing with those over the years by providing special treatment. For example, for tax and wages in arrears, they should enjoy the same equal footing as government statutory debts. making further distinction among the unsecured creditors is not in our view fair. So that's all for the first paper. I would ask my colleague to Mr. Au to walk you through the second one in a moment. Any questions on the first paper, Mr. Poon? Mr. Poon Xiuping. Well, as the government has explained in relation to the caps on preferential treatment for employees, of course, the PWIF is providing a much higher amount than 8-8. PWIF cover the amount in greater proportions, and now under the CWMPO, that is 8-8. It's only 18,000. Of course, the PWIF, after making the payments to the employees, they will stand in and claim for payments at present. Well, no one is suggesting moving amendments. But what if there's an amendment to the so-called 828 provision, because it's remained the same for decades? But there's a reason for that. In the past decades, we have moved many amendments to the company's ordinance. With the establishment of the PWIF, the employees are getting the assistance in case of winding up. As I mentioned last time, there's an issue with 8-8. And the money to be recouped under this provision will go to the PWIF, not to the employee concerned. And there has not been any case whereby we need to do more for the PWIF. But if we increase the caps from the present 8-8 level, then the situation will be as what we have described in the paper. So you are not going to consider making suitable and reasonable adjustments in line with inflation. And if there is insufficient money for the PWIF, you can, of course, adjust the levy. The point is the preferential payment levels have remained unchanged for so long. So why don't you consider whether you should make some adjustments to the caps? Well, actually, the payment will be advanced by the PWIF. So the so-called payment is not going to be received by the employee. It's going to go to the PWIF. And PWIF has no need to have the caps raised. And for years, we have not made any adjustments solely on the basis of inflation adjustment. So we don't see any reason why there is a need to make changes. Well, if members have no further question on this paper, we can move on to the next paper. It's CB1283/1516, bracket 02. Chairman, this paper sets out the government's response to four matters raised at the last meeting. First, safeguard for employees. Please speak to the mic. We can't hear you clearly. Sorry. This paper deals with four matters raised by members at the last meeting. First, safeguards for employees under the provision on transaction at an undervalue. The bill the bill's provision on a transaction at an undervalue will not hinder normal commercial transactions. For example, for in a transaction involving a director, then the consideration paid by him was not significantly less than the value of the goods or other considerations, or the transaction is enter into a good faith for the purpose of carrying on its business, and if a transaction falls under this category, it will not be affected by the provisions on transaction at an undervalue. Some members expressed concern whether there will be adverse impact on employees who receive commission from a transaction entered into by a company, and the transaction was subsequently ruled by the court as a transaction at an undervalue. Well, employees' commission is generally calculated according to employment contracts or company policies rather than a part of a transaction between the company and a third party. And the relevant commission, as the relevant provisions are applicable only to transactions which are at an undervalue, if the employee receives commission payment in accordance with prevailing arrangement of the company, in that transaction, the commission payment made to the employee would not be, in normal circumstances, be affected by provisions on transaction at an undervalue. Second issue, measures to streamline the winding up process, and that is the so-called use of agents and liquidators agents, and the appointment of lawyers to assist or solicitor to assist in the performance of the liquidator's duties. During the public consultation document, we received certain submissions, and the details are set out in paragraphs 5 and 6. Simply put, the costs or charges of the agents and the relevant provisions are there to streamline the process and to cut costs and time. The creditors will benefit from such streamlining provisions, and this is also there's also an alternative. If there is no agreement, if there's an agreement between the agent and the creditor, that then there would be the saving of time by the court to adjudicate on the fees and costs. As for the suggestions of asking a lawyer or the appointment of a lawyer in a court winding up case, well, usually this is allowed, and after the review, we believe that there is room for streamlining and hence the present proposals in the bill. And the third issue is measures relating to the redemption or buyback for a company's own shares out of capital. A member was concerned whether this proposal may hinder the normal redemption and buyback of shares by a company. We must point out that the proposal only targets a shares redemption or buyback out of the company's capital. There are other forms of buyback. For example, they would use the profits to be distributed for buyback, or use other funding mode for redemption or buyback.
The issue will not be affected by our suggested provisions. And also, members suggested last time that the proposals in this bill should be separated into different categories. Now, so we've divided these into new measures and improving measures, and these are in the enclosures, and we will introduce you further to these provisions when we come to clause-by-clause scrutiny. Any further questions? Mr. Leung Kai Cheung, Chairman. After the Bills Committee meeting last time, I heard the Deputy Secretary talking about, well, right now, to be liquidator, no qualifications are specified, but I'd like to reiterate to the committee why, from the government's perspective, why is it that no qualifications are specified for this important post? Because in many jurisdictions, there are some basic requirements. The person must be a lawyer, accountant, or company secretary, or have a special qualification on liquidation of companies. There's no such requirement right now in law. As long as you've been doing this sort of thing without any major problem, you are eligible. I wasn't quite happy with the Deputy Secretary's explanation last time. Now, will in the near future, will you take this proposal for legislation? That is, will you require qualifications for the liquidator? Because since the last meeting, friends were not, many friends were unhappy with the answer and they sought me out on this. Deputy Secretary? Now let's look at the reality. Now, when there is liquidation to be handled, the law requires there to be a liquidator or provisional liquidator. And it was determined at the time there would be no specific requirement. Now, this mechanism has been operative for a long period of time. So the post is normally filled by professionals like lawyer or liquidator. Now, under the official liquidator's office, there is a mechanism to deal with this. So perhaps I will ask my colleague to inform you on this. Ms. Tong, now right now the official receiver's office, now when there is a winding up of a company, the company's assets, if they are less than $200,000, when the liquidation order has been issued, the official receiver automatically becomes the provisional liquidator, and if he feels the company's assets are less than $200,000, he can appoint other persons to be a provisional liquidator, and we have a mechanism with a panel of persons from which we can choose who are qualified, and we will choose one of them to be a provisional liquidator. We have a vetting mechanism based on their qualifications and how many times previously they filled this post and how many staff they have for the job and so on. And these persons who are eligible is under this panel system. If the assets are under 200,000, we would take care of the assets and we would hold the meetings to see if there are opinions or suggestions from the creditors' meetings or from the company, whether they have any person in mind. And because it affects their own rights, I believe they are entitled to determine which liquidator they prefer. If they have no particular preference, then this person from the panel A, as we call it, would then be selected based on how many cases they handled before, how large is their company, the qualifications of the responsible persons in the company. So these are the criteria whereby the companies are selected for panel A, and we tell them that you can choose from the names on the panel list, and then the court is entrusted to appoint the liquidator. So these are all experienced persons. Now we will draw a line on the eligible persons. We'll have to look at the real life situation, and we have to take into account the priorities. Of course, some in the industry want there to be a registration system to rule out certain persons. But as Mr. Leung said, the current system is operating well, and if there are problems, the official receiver's office has a mechanism to deal with it, and there is means by which the court can remove the liquidator. So if we're going to draw a line, do we rule out persons other than lawyers or accountants? Well, in fact, that's not the case abroad. It's arguable, and there's competition law right now. Are only lawyers and accountants eligible? We need consultation. And if we're going to have a registration system, discussion is required. So there have been proposals from the industry. Now, we used our time well. Apart from conducting the review of the company law, we are also reviewing the winding up procedures. Now, if we're going to further draw a line on who would be eligible, that is a major issue. We believe it should be dealt with outside the discussion of this bill. And I'm not really drawing a line, Chairman. Now, you heard the official receiver say that there is a panel A with required qualifications, but people don't know how you choose these persons. Perhaps you should set that out in writing. It's nothing against competition. I want persons of different qualifications to be eligible. And you mentioned that for assets over 200,000, for those companies, the shareholders may have to hold a meeting to discuss who should be the liquidator. But it's better that there would be objective standards. It's better than the court having to remove the liquidator when something untoward happens. Now, when other pieces of legislation are in line with international financial practice, and although this matter is not urgent, I hope the next time you review this ordinance, you would put this item on your agenda next time. When you say next time, do you mean the next meeting or the next amendment? When you amend the the ordinance, I hope you would include this matter. Now, I think that government would not introduce the registration system now, but in order to protect the creditors and other interested persons, I think this has to be done. I'm not trying to narrow the market. Many persons are eligible to be liquidator. But can you say anyone with primary school qualifications are eligible? No, I'm not trying to state it to a great detail, but you should let people know who are eligible. Many people don't know. You have a selection procedure. Some people want to be on panel A. I hope there would be standards set. Chairman, I understand the members' views. As I said, in this bill, I don't think we should handle this. But next time we have a major review, we would consider this issue. Chen Yunhan, the administration has responded to the FTU on the undervalued transaction, but I think your answer is vague. For instance, in paragraph 2, the transactions in the previous 5 years, if there are undervalued transactions, they can be set aside. Now, my colleague was very clear last time. Now, before the company went out of business, they sold a lot of goods and they made a lot of money. Now, so it's not at a regular price. Now, you should maybe wait. Now, if you are going to wait for the documents for the previous 5 years, then you may have to wait a long time. Who would answer? The document is CB128. Now, before you came in, I went to another meeting. I'm sorry. Now, you can ask a question now, of course. I want to clarify one point. Now, do we need to look at the previous 5 years? Well, I have no problem with that. But let's say in this period, within the past 3 years, they have all the vouchers and they affect the employees' commissions. So you have to look up for the undervalued transactions in the previous 5 years. I'm not against that. But there are certain vouchers that are available. Do we have to wait for all that before the employees can get the money? Have you read the document? Of course, I know what we wrote. Now, if it affects the employees' commission, that doesn't have to be waiting for that 5 years documents. Now, because we are now talking about commission, it's a transaction between the company and the employee. It's a commission paid under that relationship, and it's a transaction that the court would look at. The court would look at the company's vouchers, but those are the transaction vouchers, not the commission documents.
So in this paper, we are saying that if the court rules that that's an undervalue transaction, but if the commission payment is not part of the transaction, it will not be affected by the bill. I understand that. So you mean that the commission will be paid, will be payable right away instead of waiting for 5 years. Well, it's impossible for the employee to wait for 5 years before getting the commission. Chairman, you are a very different chairman than the one this morning. I was not allowed to ask my question because I was late. When an employee applies for payment from PWIF, they may face different problems. Maybe the Labor Department will not recognize the wage records, or maybe the ruling from the Labor Tribunal has to be sought first. So, Mr. Ho, how do you deal with problems like this? So there are two things here. First, whether the company, the person in charge of the company has gone missing. Actually, there's no need for the person to turn up to do the winding up procedure himself. We need the court to grant an order, and then we'll get a provisional liquidator to carry out the procedure. Of course, in cases of wages in arrears, the employees would go to the Labor Department to seek assistance, and the Labor Department would offer assistance in accordance with their policies. I have a look into this with the Labor Department. If we encounter such a case, we will, of course, refer to the case to the Labor Department. In the case of DSC, yes, the Labor Department has told me that they did a lot to handle the matter. But of course, different people may see things differently. When an application is made to the PWIF, where you need to adduce, you provide evidence or proof, and we're talking about here the policies adopted by the PWIF. We have actually verbally informed the Labor Department of our views. But within the scope of this bill, and also within the scope of companies winding up, we have already streamlined the matter. We can handle cases whereby the person in charge of the company is not present, and the application submitted to the PWIF has to meet certain criteria. We have reflected our concerns to the Labor Department and the PWIF. When in a case of insolvency, involving wages in arrear, you have to deal with different parties, the employer, the employee, and the PWIF. Well, there are certain incidental matters arising from a winding up process. When a company has gone insolvent, you have to look at the source of the problem. Although it may not be in this bill, the PWIF is supposed to provide urgent assistance, but in that case, the whole process took more than a year. I am encouraged by your attitude change. You're more willing to help now. I want you would like to help us speeding up the process. But the employee face this problem, and that is the case, has to be heard by the Labor Tribunal before an order is granted and PWIF offers assistance. And you're saying that this is the work of the Labor Department. It seems that no one wants to touch this. You have to deal with these obstacles which no one wants to handle. Well, the liquid data, Ernst Young was very good because they had to deal with MPF, and they called the bank and solved the problems immediately. Because if you did what Mr. Ho you have suggested, the PWRF would not be able to offer timely assistance. So when there's an insolvency case, you need to overcome this obstacle, i.e. the case must go to the labor tribunal first. Well, I don't mind if a case is controversial and you should handle the case more carefully. So what's your shortcut you propose? Well, there should be an alternative arrangement. All right? The member would like to see something done. As to how to do it, it's your bureau's problem. You can't ignore the problem. Or perhaps you can make a suggestion at the relevant bureau or bureaus will handle this. Which one? I think it's your bureau. If it's not your bureau, then which bureau? Please inform Ms. Chan. And then I will pursue the matter with that bureau. Well, we have liaised with the labor department. We have talked to them and we have discussed the matter with them. PWIF is really helpful, although it has also been criticized. You just want the PWIO to be able to do more and more quickly. We've heard you, but the government must hand over the matter to the relevant authority. So we're going to faithfully relay your views to the Labor and Welfare Bureau and the Labor Department to see how we can take things forward. Mr. Ho, after you have contacted them again, please inform us in writing. Although you may claim that this is not a matter for you, objectively speaking. At present, the process is a time-consuming one. It takes a long time. I don't know whether this can be done because it's a headache for the labor unions. It can take more than one and a half year to get everything completed. All right, so please provide the information requested by the member in writing later. Mr. Kenneth Lau, the Deputy Secretary, refer to the CB1-283-1516-02, and that is the government's response to our four matters. May I refer everyone to the paragraph 8 and the annex point 8, section 276 of the company's WUNMP ordinance. Which paper, please, again? CB1-283/15-16-02. The one we referred to a moment ago. And that's an annex. Please refer to the annex to the paper, page 3, point number 8. Which refers to section 276 of Companies Writing of Miscellaneous Provision Ordinance and also section 205 in the same ordinance. The bill would clarify the contradictions between Section 276 and 205. So I believe the intention is that Section 276 would override Section 205. Deputy Secretary, which comes first, Section 276 or 205? But this is a controversial matter. So the amendment would specify the under specified circumstances who should be responsible for what. So you are not going to change the two sections. Are you going to have a new provision linking the two or cross-reference the two or what? Actually, this is a clarification. Are we going to amend an existing provision? Both provisions, both sections will be amended. So there will be a cross-reference between the two. When we go by cross-examination, I would look at them in greater detail. All right, Mr. Christopher Zhang, Chairman. I want to talk about clause 88 to 96, transaction at an undervalue. But you know that running a business can be risky. You can make a loss, you can make a profit. If a government has to sell something in distress, and of course, under some such circumstances, if you want to sell things quickly, you have to sell at a lower price. So what? When will a transaction become an undervalued transaction? When the discrepancy between the normal and the lower price is at a certain level? And also, you have to look at transactions in 5 years. You can set aside those transactions. How can you trace the transactions enter into a number of years ago? What protection is afforded to employees? And then the relevant matter or asset might have changed hands a few times. So what would you do about that? Well, this is something that can happen before and after the bill is enacted. Although we're talking about new winding up procedure, but for bankruptcy and for the UK companies and legislation, they have been adopting this for a long time. There are so many different scenarios, but the court has already got a set of approach adopted to rule whether a transaction is an undervalued transaction, and if so, how to do the restitution. So we cannot be too general about what would be done if there are three onward further transactions. We cannot adopt a box-ticking approach. And for different industries, the value may be different as regards what constitutes undervalued, but the problem is that the issue is that we have to make sure that the transactions are bona fide. If you don't understand what is meant by the transaction for significantly less than the value, as long as the company enter into the transaction in good faith, and it's considered in the benefit of the company. We believe such provisions offer a better protection for the company. But if we do nothing, you may think that is good for the company, but then it's going to disadvantage the creditor. So we have looked at the wording adopted in the common law jurisdictions and relevant case law, and we have adopted those in the bill. Young people find it difficult to buy homes, and very often the down payment will be advanced by their parents. And then if the parents become bankrupt because of business failure, would that down payment be recovered? I think this is not relevant here. We should discuss this on another occasion. This is not about bankruptcy cases. What can happen to a company? Who can take this question? Otherwise, it would be very bad for young people. Well, actually, we are talking about winding up of companies. And if it's a company, it's a sole proprietorship set up by a parent, it's a different matter. If we have a company with one director, that is the so-called one-member company, if the director just use the company's money for the benefit of the director's son, well, it can be a transaction at an undervalue if the money is just handed over like that.
It's a one-man company. One man can organize a company and he paid taxes, and then he took part of the company's profits for down payment for his son, and then he continues to operate, and then 3 or 4 years later the problem occurs. So this gift, previous gift, this transaction doesn't have to be reversed. Now, it only applies when the company is insolvent. If the company at the time was not insolvent, then this transaction wouldn't be. So when the gift was made, there was no insolvency. It's 3 or 4 years later that the company became insolvent, then it doesn't count. Now, if you make the payment and it causes the company to be insolvent, then that counts. Let me change around the question to see whether there can be an explanation. The disposable profits after tax that is the company at the time was making money. So the company made some profits, so that's why I received it. Now I allocated the money to make down payment for my son, and then a number of years later, the company runs into losses and becomes insolvent, and it has to be liquidated. Now, will it affect the distribution? Well, is it dividends from the disposable profits? So the transaction would be set aside. Now, it's only in the case of undervalued transaction. I don't think this would be an undervalued transaction. Mr. Cheung is talking about a transaction that seems to be very simple. Well, suppose there is an official receiver and it's found out that hundreds of thousands have been given to their son. If it's not after-tax disposable profits, then there's a problem with the company's account. If I take money out of the current account of the company, then it's a loan by the company. It should be in current account. If the company has profits, if it's a one-man company and it distributes dividends to itself, then the company is already, the money is already out of the company. Then the taking of the money is a legal distribution of profits. So there's nothing wrong with this, and then the company is not well run, and then the company folds in 3 years. So I think that should be dealt with separately, and I believe Mr. Cheung can set his heart at ease. Well, the bill should be clear. I think this is already very clear in the existing law, because the ordinance makes it clear that it's only when the company is insolvent that this type of transaction is covered. If the company was solvent at the time, then this transaction would be effective. Now, we have resolved the concern, but we can look at this in greater detail when it comes to clause-by-clause scrutiny. Can our legal advisor explain? Now, in the third type of situation mentioned by Christopher Cheung, it should be two different matters, is it? Thank you, Chairman. Now, in the way the bill is drafted, as I see it, now the discussion just now I agree with, we are talking about undervalued transaction with a special meaning, and that includes gift and a transaction at a value that's lower than the proper value. And if the members want to look at the definition, it's in 265 capital E. It says very clearly the meaning of undervalued transaction, transaction undervalue. And if now member just now asked whether it's an undervalued transaction in that special case. Now it depends on how that occurred. If, as the chairman said, there's no reason. Now, if the money is taken out of the company and not after distribution of profits, then the company is liquidated. I believe there's a problem still. When the company is liquidated, this transaction would be revisited. And just now members asked if, now just now Mr. Cheung mentioned that situation, if at the time the profits have been distributed, the company was making profits, and the profits were distributed to shareholders, and the shareholders received the money, and then spends that money that belongs to the shareholder, then I don't believe that's covered as under this bill as a transaction under value. Now, but if there are two, there is another type of situation other than the two just mentioned, then we have to look at the specifics. Mr. Cheung, now, we have this undervalued transaction provision. That's mainly for a company facing winding up. Now, if the assets were transferred at a low value, disposed of cheaply, then when the administration wants to liquidate the company, then there would be a retracing over 5 years. Now, 2 years is easy, but 5 years is very difficult. Now, under the accountancy provisions, now, records are kept for 7 years, right? Now, if there has to be an investigation, 5 years is not a problem. And for undervalued transactions, if I'm not selling the company's assets cheaply, if I deceive someone outside, I get their assets and then I dispose of those assets cheaply. So suppose there is deceitful behavior towards the suppliers and he gets the goods, sell them cheaply for cash, then this would go beyond winding up issues. This would be deceit. This may be criminal. So we can study this further. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. Now, I still want to ask about transaction and undervalue. Now, the time limit is 5 years from the liquidation date. Now, before this amendment bill, the court, I believe, already has the power to set aside these undervalued transactions. But if you set the time limit at 5 years, sometimes the transactions are not very clear. There may be a whole series of transactions which span more than 5 years. And you have a 5-year limit. So does this bill give the court flexibility to handle events that happen before the 5 years, that extends into the 5-year period? Would those transactions also be set aside? Deputy Secretary, if the events go beyond 5 years, of course we have to draw a line. We cannot have indefinite restitution. Now, I understand members' questions. Some transactions may be complicated. Some things happened before but extend into the 5-year period. One has to look at the actual wording we use. First, we need to draw the line. Now, even if you, whatever line you draw, the same problem would occur. Then some transactions would not be very clear. They may have occurred before the 5-year period and extend into the 5-year period. I think we need to differentiate. My inclination, okay, I give you an example. If someone wants to engage in fraud, he can engage in a series of transactions, some of them more than 5 years ago. And there are different steps in a scheme. Now, some steps took place more than 5 years ago. Overall, you are looking at the same transaction because, as the chairman said, this may be a very insidious type of behavior. Now, I read some taxation legislation. When there are linked transactions, you need provisions to plug the loophole, because according to the existing wording of your bill, the the court does not have the option to extend the 5-year period. It's a rigid limit, but if you have a preconceived series of transactions, premeditated series of transactions, then you have to look into whether this person is Machiavellian enough to plan the whole series of transactions. So please give that some thought. Any further questions by members? We still have an extra hour. I'd like to ask the Deputy Secretary, do you want to go into clause-by-clause scrutiny? We are fully prepared. It depends on the wishes of the committee. Now, you know there is a lot of traffic jam in Legco. You have a highway open to you today. Certainly, I will take it if the committee agrees. Any member who doesn't agree? No? No one objects? So we can step on the gas. So I will now. So let's use the marked up copy, okay? Cross by cross scrutiny, we use the marked up copy.
It's a paper 197, CB1 197, 1516, bracket 01. Okay. So this is the markup copy. First, part one, preliminary. Short title and commencement. The commencement date will be the announced through a Gazette notice. So that's one and two. Then three to 118. Amendment to the to cap 32. There are two types. First of all, the substantive amendments to the relevant companies winding up and miscellaneous provisions ordinance, and there are also structural amendments. At present, the ordinance have divisions, parts, and so on. So we are going to number the relevant division for easier reference. So it's we are now on clause 3. This is to amend the long title of the ordinance. It's related to clause 12. For Roman 4a, the words of directors will be substituted by orders, because the orders is not really confined to directors or order of directors. So at the same time, we have to amend the long titles to make it consistent. So that's clause 3. Next, clause 4 is about the structure. after the amendment, there will be a division 1 covering section 1. And then we move on to clause 5. I think you should tell us the page number in the markup copy.
We don't
want to have to refer to both the blue bill and the markup copy. It's clause 5. Again, it's an amendment to the structure of the ordinance. Can you please refer to CB1197/15/16/01, the one prepared? We're now on 0002, page 002. It's a structural amendment. Interpretation and specification of forms, and the words division 2 is added, and then 0002 contributory. That's a subsequent amendment. So instead of one section 171 is substituted by 171(1), and then next nothing on page 3, 4, 6. It's a technical amendment. Liquidator, the interpretation of liquidator by virtue of section 194 is the original version. Because there are some other amendments, we're going to have 194-1A or AA or 1A. So we want to clarify the interpretation here. Please wait. Legal advisor, on page 6, 0006, under the definition of liquidator, the chairman mentions at the outset of the meeting that Legal Services Division has sent a letter to the government, and a question has been raised. And now you, instead of 194, you mentioned 194 subsection something. So should we also include a 194(DA)? Members may also refer to page 48, where you can see 194. Let's go to page 48.
咁咧，我哋覺得咧呢個嘅釋義嗰度咧都應該係。
We don't think there's a need to change the interpretation of this term, because for the addition subsection DA, a provisional liquidator. We regard it as a provisional liquidator under 194(1) a. So there's no need to add the reference to 194(DA). So by virtue of a 194(1A), the provisional liquidator is so recognized. Yes, the provisional liquidator will be deemed as a provisional liquidator by virtue of 194(1AA). Nothing on page 7, nothing on page 8, page 9, Chinese version, a technical amendment. We have included in the bill some terms. Unfair preference transaction at an undervalue. So these terms are added to the relevant suitable places. Please continue. Page 10, Chinese version. It's again a technical amendment.
題目就是加上這個標題號碼。
Okay, 等等我們...
We'll add division 1. We'll get the number. This is also covered by a question raised in the letter sent to the government. Mention has been made about transaction at an undervalue, the Chinese translation, and also the unfair preference. In our previous discussion, we talked about that in case of bankruptcy, the Cap 6, both matters are also covered. But the Chinese version is quite different. For the English term of unfair practice, in Cap 6, it's called 不公平的優惠 in Chinese, for unfair preference, for 順直交易 in Chinese, for transaction at an undervalue, is rendered as 以低於一般價值訂立的交易. So if there are further references to these two matters, are we going to use the new Chinese terms? And there's a difference between the Cap 6 and Cap 32. Are you going to amend Cap 6? Should the question be answered by the DOJ or by the Bureau?
我可以解釋一下這個問題的。
Let me explain why we have this issue. In this bill, we use the Chinese term 順直交易 for transaction at an undervalue or 不公平優惠 for unfair preference. We want to use the simplified terms for easier reading. Because a shorter term is easier to understand. So we have introduced 順直交易 in Chinese for transaction at an undervalue and 不公平優惠 for unfair preference. So if there are further provisions added to Cap 6, we are going to use the same terms. But for other ordinances outside of Cap 32, and if in the future similar terms are used, we would make a decision as regards whether we should use the same Chinese terms as in this bill. Turning to Cap 30, Cap 6, 低於 現實價值的訂立的交易, I'll leave it to the Bureau to see whether they would like to make any amendments to Cap 6. Official receiver? Well, Cap 6 has got its own case law, and the meaning can be expressed properly, so we have no plan to amend Cap 6. So Cap 6 would adhere to the old terms. Okay, please continue. Page 10, structural amendment is the same for 11. We just add the number for the division. Division 2, page 12, division 3 is added. It's the same for page 13, division 4 is added. Page 14, management and administration to be deleted entirely. Under this Roman 4, Well, they have been repealed. We are now repealing the reference to the section numbers.
And this is just to make it more succinct. So from pages 14 through 20, we are just removing the rubbish, right? Then on page 21, as we mentioned just now, now in part Roman numeral 4a, now the the heading is changed to because the removal of the qualifications, we changed the heading to be in to be consistent with the contents. So no questions. Page 22. Here is just a technical amendment in 168D, 1B. Originally, it's a liquidator of a company, and then we add provisional liquidator or to make the meaning more clear. And same situation in page 23. Now we add provisional liquidator to make the meaning more complete. (168G) bracket 1. The arrow should be after the word or. Okay, I see, there's a comma. No problem. Page 24. This involves to the personal liable to a disqualifications order. Now, there's an amendment here. Now, this has to be to do with the power to order a public examination. So, during winding up on the amendment in connection with this public examination, we will explain again when we come to section 90 something. Legal advisor, now the bracket 7 that's the deleted compared to the original one, there's a one thing has been removed, that is the report would be delivered to the person who would be subject to examination. And in our letter, we asked for one clarification. It seems that the new bracket 7 doesn't say that the copy of the report would be sent to the person who would be examined. Now, why is it that this right is lost, and if the report is not received by the person, the subject of the inquiry, then how does he know about the case involving him? Now, this amendment is in relationship to the proposals we received during public consultation. Now, the document submitted to the court, it's in the grounds. The suggestion is that it would not be made available for inspection, but except when the court has an order, made an order, and if the report is disclosed to the person subject to the inquiry, then the order may fail in its objective. So in order to maintain confidentiality, we will not provide the report to the person who may be examined. However, there would be a safeguard for him. Now, according to the Company Liquidation Rule 51A, I believe it's on page 235, a Chinese version. Now, it would be used in procedures for which 57A is applicable, and the report is confidential, and in para 2, it says that a person who is the subject of a public examination order being applied for may apply to the court to see all or part of the report, and if the person satisfies the court that it would be unfair to the person not to see it, the court may allow the person to see all or part of the report subject to any condition that he thinks fit. So here there is a safeguard for the person subject to the examination. So the person subject to examination would automatically receive the official receiver's report. Now that's the original arrangement, but now you've changed it so that it's available only after the court issues an order. Now, whenever somebody is rights is reduced, LegCo is always concerned. So can the administration supply us with a document? Now, this removal of the right to receive a copy of the official receiver's report in advance to maintain confidentiality, can you provide us with a document to explain to us? Now, concerning this change, it's for a reason, because now in bankruptcy ordinance, now there are public examination procedures in the case of personal bankruptcy, and there are similar provisions in UK legislation. So there are similar practices there. So here we are trying to adapt the provisions here to those legislation. Now, we're not trying to make you add a new provision. We just ask you to supply a document to show us that you have reason and basis for this amendment, because these documents are needed for our files, for our records. Please resume. On pages 24, 25, and 26, they are all about what we've examined, the public examination, and then we come to page 27, there are no changes. Then we come to, as well, both changes, pages 27 and 28 are about the disqualification order. Now it's a technical change. After examining the relevant provisions, on page 28, in C, under disqualification order, now and we add 307N1 in Securities and Futures Ordinance because we think that this is also applicable here. Next, page 29, it's just structural amendment, part 5, winding up, that is divided to different divisions and subdivisions, and same for page 30, subdivision 2, that's now a new section, a contribution, a new subdivision, contribution. Now, starting from page 31, now when we talked about policies just now, we talked about redemptions and buybacks. These are the relevant provisions. So, so this is under the new 170A. So this is the section where we have the provisions about the redemption and buyback of shares. Legal advisor, I also asked a question about this. Now, a member might have noticed that the new 170 capital A right now, the way it's written mentions shareholders. Now, in my letter, we mentioned, now in Cap 32, shareholders is expressed as members. And in the bill, there are no other provisions which use the term shareholder. So I don't know whether, for the sake of consistency, instead of using shareholder, we would use the word member in 170 capital A. Now, on the term shareholder, it's only in 170A, and it's a definition within 170A. It's only within this 170A, so it would not affect other provisions. It's merely a definition. In English, it's shareholder, it's not member. Can you explain why you need to specify shareholder and not member here? Now, the law draftsman suggested this term, that it would be used here only. Yes, but why? But why? Perhaps the law draftsman can explain. Now, 170A, this provision, we have referred to the Insurance Act in the UK, so we use the word shareholders.
In due course, we'll work out a written reply with the Bureau, and we would elaborate when that's ready. If we use members in the rest of the bill, would there be any problem? We need to carefully consider this proposal. I hope the Bureau will come up with CSA because we have been saying that we want to have consistency of terms. We also refer to overseas laws. And we would like to make use of the same terms for different provisions. I just don't want to make things more complicated. It's just a technical consideration. Please continue. Chairman. 31, 32, 33 are also on buyback and share redemption. Legal advisor. On page 32, Chinese version, it's a 170 capital A bracket 5. We raised a question about this in our letter. The wording, bracket 5, is like this. Section 170 does not apply in relation to liability accruing under this section. And our question is this. It's not clear it's not clear what intention lies behind the wording used here. If you say that section 170 doesn't apply to section 170 capital A, there's no need to talk about liability accruing under this section, i.e. 170A. But if you are saying that part of section 170 does not apply here, perhaps you can spell it out? The Bureau or the DOJ? Thank you for your question, legal advisor. We are still studying the questions raised in your letter you sent us last week. We'll carefully consider all the points and then give you a written reply in due course. Can you please address this point at the next meeting? Because you haven't actually replied to our previous letter. All right, you may now continue. We'll put down a marker for this. Page 34. Again, it's a structural amendment. 35, the same. We just add the words subdivision 2. No problem. 36. This is about amending section 178 of the ordinance. And that is that's about the prescribed form for the notice. For written demand. No problem. 36, 37, and now we are on 38. There's a structural amendment, i.e. the words subdivision 3 are added to the subdivision. Next. Thirty-nine. Again, it's related to buyback and redemption. Some consequential amendments. And the reference is made to 170 capital A, the new provision on buyback and redemption. Page 40. Two structural amendments, the addition of the word subdivision 4 and subdivision 5, and then the next page is the same, subdivision 6 are added, and then, yes, the numbers are added for the subdivisions 4, 5, and 6. All right, we can move on. Page 42. Amendments to section 190. the statement of assets and liabilities. They are textual amendments. Legal advisor, under this section, and that is bracket 2, capital B, on page 42, the affidavit of concurrence. I've raised a question about this in the letter. The one who make the affidavit, if the maker of the affidavit is not in agreement with the maker of the statement, so under 2B, A, B, C, he may be qualified to deal with the statement of affairs. That is, the liquidator or the provisional liquidator may require for the submission of the affidavit. The one who make, what's the purpose of making the affidavit of a concurrence? So is it really appropriate to call it an affidavit of concurrence if the maker is not in agreement with another maker of the statement? Well, here we are referring to the UK Act. It is called affidavit of concurrence in the UK Act. It's just a name, a title. And the use is very carefully spelled out in the bill. But of course, if members want to use another term, we can certainly look into the proposal. But we can accept this term, which we borrow from the UK Act. Do you have any suggestion, legal advisor? Thank you, Chairman. Members may also refer to Capital 2, Capital 2, Capital A. And it mentions the use of the affidavit of concurrence, as the name suggests. The maker concurs with the matters stated in the statement, and then 2B allows some qualification to be made to the extent that the maker can say that he's not in agreement with the maker of the statement. So you tell us the use of the affidavit of concurrence, and then you allow the maker to make qualify the concurrence to the extent that it can mean this agreement. So you might as well do away with the words of concurrence. Just call it an affidavit. So please consider this. Use a reasonable term. Otherwise, if Mr. Wong Yong Man is here, he will have a lot to say about how bad it is. Page 42, we have covered 42, 43, 44 is actually the same amendments. 45, a new provision, newly added, section 190, capital A. This is a technical amendment. In the ordinance 190(4) and also rule 43 of the rules are duplications. So this is a technical amendment. We put all everything in the new 190 capital A. Page 46. Oh, wait, please wait. It seems to me that the reference to a affidavit of concurrence appears on several in several subsections. So if you decide to make amendments, please make sure that all those terms are amended at the same time. 46 is about public examination and the report. We promised to give the Bills Committee a written response in which we would elaborate on the matters mentioned on page 46. Page 47, amendment to section 193 of the ordinance so as to clarify the meaning. And that is the provisional liquidator has to discharge the duties as directed by the court, and the court may decide the fees and to be received by the provisional liquidator, and also the power of the court to accept the resignation of the provisional liquidator, and so on and so forth. So this forms a clarified system for the appointment and removal of provisional liquidator. We have a question about page 47, 193, bracket 7, or bracket 6 and bracket 7. There are provisions to terminate the appointment of a provisional liquidator and to provide for the acceptance of resignation. But in section 193, there are no provisions in the case of vacancies arising from removal or termination of appointment or resignation of a provisional liquidator. Maybe the government should consider providing some provisions to deal with such situations. Yes, as we have mentioned, so we are going to give a full account to the observation, to the suggestion in our written reply. So it seems that you have not been able to reply in writing to so many issues raised by our legal advisor. Well, it's because we only received your letter last Friday. Page 48. Amendments to section 194. Again, this is for the clarification purpose. So after an order is granted, if there's a vacancy of a provisional liquidator, the official receiver will become the provisional liquidator. And people who are appointed under 3, and if he acts in the capacity of a provisional liquidator, he will be deemed to be a liquidator holding office by virtue of paragraph 1941AA, 1941 capital A. This is to avoid, for the purpose of avoiding confusion. 50, page 50. Amendments to section 196. And after the winding up order is granted, a provisional or liquidators appointed under 194 should be able to receive remuneration in accordance with 196, section 196, because at present some practitioners find the relevant provisions rather confusing. 194 is an existing section, and in bracket 2, we have a question in respect of subsection 2. Where the official receiver is the liquidator of the company, he may at any time apply to the court for the appointment of a person as a liquidator in his place. So the question is this. There's no corresponding provision to cater for a case whereby someone else other than the official receiver is the liquidator. That liquidator cannot apply to the court for the appointment of another liquidator to take his place. So the question is, why is it that only a particular liquidator may apply to the court for this purpose? Or rather, should all liquidators be allowed to make the same application? Mr. Au, again, this point will be responded to in our written reply.
主席，接住落嚟，我哋就應該去到第51頁面咗。
Page 51. We're now on page 52. It's a reenacted section 199, and a new section 199 capital A, 199 capital B. The purpose is to set out or to modernize the powers of the liquidator, and also for elucidation.
There is no real difference. It's just to modernize the expression. So you merely update the amendments. Legal advisor? A small query as mentioned in the letter. Now we have to look at the English version because the Chinese version doesn't apply with regard to my query. Now looking at 199 bracket 6, that is on page 52 of the English version. The other provision is 199 capital A on page 55 bracket 3, and another one on page 56, 199 capital B bracket 7. Now these three seem to be the same, but in the English version in 199 capital B bracket 7 on page 56, it seems to miss out a few words. It seems to miss out the words for direction. I'd just like to see whether the administration would provide an amendment. Thank you. It seems that there is an omission. We will go back and take a look and we'll respond in writing. If it's missing, we will make an amendment. So please deal with that at the next meeting. And I also like to supplement on section 199. Now, these are for clarification. And on the liquidator's rights, we've made changes according to the proposed suggestions. The liquidator with the concurrence of the creditors' meeting, can appoint a lawyer. This power does not have to receive the court's consent. So this is the change. It's made according to the suggestions. Any question? If not, we resume. Page 57. Is to amend section 203. This is to modernize the provisions so that there's no rigid requirement to print the accounts because there will be subsequent provisions for the liquidator to make electronic communication, same for page 58, yes. Now, page 59, that's to amend section 205. It says that if a liquidator passes away, then his Now, the his personal representative can apply to take over the duties, and page 60, that's a continuation. We have to end at 6:30. I think we will start our scrutiny next time from page 61. Now, Mr. Alan Leong is now back. He was going to ask a question. So we use this time for your questions. I just have a couple of comments. We thank the government for supplying the document CB1 283/615-16(2). Right now it's in English, and in the annex it responded to my question for assistance from the administration so that we know which parts of the bill are new and which parts have already been done by the court for a long time, but it's merely codified. Now, I'd like to ask, for instance, page 1, new measures 1. I hope the simultaneous interpreters can excuse me, because this is the English version, so I will quote in English. Now, in 1, it says transaction and undervalue. Now, this is what... thank you, this is a Chinese version. Transaction and undervalue. Now, my understanding is that right now, when companies are wound up, the court, when it deals with the liquidator's report, it already made such orders. That is, if during 1 to 5 years before liquidation, there was an undervalue transaction, the court already has the power to demand that the losses to shareholders be borne by the directors or shareholders who caused all this. Now, I believe the court is already exercising the power. I don't know whether this is same as now, so this is already power exercised by the court through its rulings, and you are now codified them into law in a more systematic way. Now, this is my understanding, so I'd like to ask about this from the official receiver's office. Now, are you talking about the personal bankruptcy procedures or some other legislation? Now, the member is asking document 283/15-16(02). Now, transaction at an undervalue. Now, this is now part of the ordinance. Now, in the past, the court already took that action. There have already been such cases. What I mean is, I like to understand. Now, I'm just giving an example. Now, under the new measures, you have set out 6 items. Now, in column 2, you say that there are no corresponding provisions in current legislation. I agree with that. There's no. Now, in under company's ordinance, when it's dealing with winding up, there is no relevant provision. That's true. But even though there is no codified provision in this context, yet when the court takes over the liquidators from the liquidator, and the liquidator submits a report by affidavit, and he would say that he has made an examination. Now, in the 5 years preceding the liquidation order, there were the following transactions at undervalue. And when the court received that report, even though there is no codified law right now, in previous rulings, the court did make issue orders, ordering the shareholders or directors responsible to make up with their own money. Now, am I correct in my understanding? I believe if Mr. Leong is talking about the breach of duty or breach of trust situations under common law. Now, the rulings are not affected. Now, why do I take this example? I want other members to understand. You say this is entirely new provision, but it's not entirely new. It's just that, as the assistant official receiver mentioned, perhaps they had to deploy some principles in law of equity. Now, I like to ask, I want just to let other members understand, especially when we go to council meeting, that this is not created out of nothing. Under the existing system, the court does act by principles of equity to get some money for the creditors. So you can provide case law in our discussion at this Bills Committee. This will enrich the discussion so that we can focus on whether the provisions are adequate, because the original court assistance, whether it's the court remedy is enough, because that remedy is rather complicated. So yes, I think we can use this help when it comes to third reading. Now, not at that stage perhaps, but even during clause by clause scrutiny, during that stage, I think members can benefit. I think there are three or more such instances.
Come on.
All right, we are coming to the end of the meeting. The date of the next meeting, we have scheduled two so far. First one, 11th of January, a Monday at 8:30 a.m. Second meeting, 25th of January, again a Monday at 8:30 a.m. Don't complain that the time is too early. Well, we will have a PWSC or ESC. Well, it's not a Wednesday. Well, we also have PWSC and ESC meetings on Monday. Well, the usual slot is on Wednesday, additional meetings may be scheduled for Monday. There's no need to worry. There's no way you can worry about this. If there's a big backlog, there's only our only way is to wriggle out of it as best we can. It's a tentative timetable. The legal advisor has raised many questions. Well, actually, the questions have been sent in the form of a letter to the Bureau, but today's meetings came a bit too early for the written reply to be ready. Okay, I mean for next meeting. Yes, I will ask the Bureau to give us the written response by the 11th of January. Thank you. Meeting's adjourned.